Good afternoon and welcome to the Bardo Arts Center at Western Carolina University's virtual programming. I'm Denise Drury-Homewood, Director of the Bardo Arts Center, and I'm so glad you could join us today for one of several virtual public programs that are happening each Thursday in April. We've transitioned many of our public programs to virtual live platforms with the goal of engaging our community while we're all staying home to keep our community safe from COVID-19. Today's talk centers around one of the WCU Fine Art Museum's spring exhibitions, Time and Again, Glassworks by Kit Paulson and Sarah Beth Post. Featuring works in glass, exploring ideas about time, history, memory, and the antique. Today's discussion will be facilitated by WCU Fine Art Museum Curator of Collections and Exhibitions, Carolyn Grosch, and include these exhibiting artists. At 12:30, we'll open it up to questions from our audience watching on Facebook and YouTube. And our goal of these public talks is to really engage you. So be thinking about questions you have for our exhibiting artists and Carolyn throughout the presentation, and post your questions in the comment section, and we'll get to as many as we can throughout the presentation. Before I turn it over to Carolyn, I want to thank a few people who are making this event possible behind the scenes. Sam Wallace, WCU's Director of Photography and Videography Services, who is facilitating the video feed, Riley Rockmore, WCU Social Media and Digital Content Strategist, and Bardo Art Center's own Jill Jacobs, both of whom who are fielding questions from YouTube and Facebook. I also want to acknowledge the Art Alliance for Contemporary Glass and thank them for their generous grant funding, which has helped to realize this exhibition and public programming. So with that, I'll turn it over to Carolyn, who will introduce our speakers for today.
Thanks, Denise. I'm Carolyn Grosch. I'm the Curator of Collections and Exhibitions at the WCU Fine Art Museum. And today I'm really excited that our virtual talk centers around glass and is inspired by our current exhibition, Time and Again. Western Carolina University has a long history of presenting exhibitions about glass. And starting in the 1970s, Professor Emerita Joan Falconer Bird, who taught ceramics at Western for many years, began curating a long series of exhibitions celebrating the remarkable work in glass being produced right here in North Carolina. The WCU Fine Art Museum continues this tradition with the Time and Again exhibition by bringing together the work of two artists, Kit Paulson and Sarah Beth Post, who are currently living and working in North Carolina and are both based at the Penland School of Craft. The works in the exhibition are on loan from the artists, as well as Momentum Gallery in downtown Asheville. As the title of the exhibition suggests, time is an important element in both artists' work. And not only time, but other ideas that revolve around time. So history, memory, a fascination with the antique. In many of their works, objects from the past are revived, remade, and reimagined in glass, ultimately creating a bridge between past and present. With us today are Sarah Beth Post, who holds a Bachelor of Fine Arts in Glass from the University of Louisville, and she's pursuing a two-year work study opportunity as a core fellow at the Penland School of Craft. She's also worked as a cold shop coordinator at Pilchuck Glass School and as an assistant and studio tech at the Corning Museum of Glass. She uses a casting technique to recreate childhood objects in glass and is drawn to antique toys and dolls, some which are tied to her own family. Sarah Beth casts these objects in glass as a way to cherish past moments and to create a heightened experience of the objects as precious and frozen in time. Her work examines the psychology and unreliability of memory and comments on how the present informs our views of the past. Also with us today is Kit Paulson, who holds a Master of Fine Arts from Southern Illinois University and a Bachelor of Fine Arts from Alfred University. She's completed residencies around the world from Norway to Tacoma, Washington, and has taught glasswork at numerous schools, including Pilchuck Glass School, Corning Museum of Glass, the National College of Art and Design in Ireland, and Canberra Glassworks in Australia. Kit is currently in her second year of a three-year residency at Penland, and specializes in torchworked glass, producing finely detailed, intricate glass structures, many which are wearable, that reflect on the passage of time and connect with artifacts from past eras. Above all, she seeks to rekindle our society's appreciation for ornament by producing objects of extraordinary detail and craftsmanship. So welcome, Kit and Sarah Beth. It's so good to have you here. Thank you for being with us today for this conversation. I'd love to start by asking you how you got started working in glass and what drew you to this incredible medium. So Kit, maybe we can start with you.
Yeah, sure. So I started working with glass in art school. So when I went for my Bachelor of Fine Arts, I started working in glass my second year of school. Mostly, it was sort of accidental. So I signed up for a wood class, and I ended up not being able to take that wood class, and glass was the only thing open. And the first day of glass blowing, I thought it was absolutely terrible. In fact, so terrible that I went out in the hall and I cried about it because I knew I was stuck there for an entire semester. And then somehow that sort of terror and horror of the material turned into fascination. And eventually I just got totally involved with it, and I've been involved with glass for almost the past 20 years.
Great. Sarah Beth, how about you? How did you get started working in glass?
I fortunately had an interest in glass when I was in high school, and my community college in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania offered glass blowing, and there was a fusing area. It's a really small program. So right after high school, I started with glass there. And I think similar to Kit, it's very terrifying being in the pot shop, but it's also like just draws you in so much. And I was really fortunate that the teacher at the time, Helen Tegler, would allow me to work with her after school during her blow slots. So I got to have a lot more kind of like individual concentration. And it was really awesome studio. So it was outside under this coverage. And we also were super influenced by cold working and working in the kiln when the weather was really bad, because we kind of blew glass because it was outdoors.
Yeah, so I'm really intrigued by your process for both of you. And, you know, Kit, I think you are primarily known for your torch work. Sarah Beth, you're known for your casting. I'm wondering if you could tell us a little bit about your process and you know, what your approach to what your approach is to making glass objects. Do you want to start?
You want me to start?
That'd be great.
Yes. Okay. So I am now a flame worker. I started out in the hot shop, which is a larger scale working with glass, and then have gradually moved away from that into flame working. But because of that, I tend to approach flame working from maybe more of a larger scale glass perspective. And a lot of my work starts out with a very detailed scale drawing, which I then transfer onto a piece of kiln shelf. And then I work directly onto that drawing with glass. So it's very, very similar to drawing. It's almost as close as you can get to drawing in glass.
Yeah, great. And Sarah Beth, tell us a little bit about your casting process.
Yeah, I typically start with forms that I'm just really drawn to. Specific to the show, a lot of the forms are clothes from dolls, and I'll make molds directly off of the clothing. So I'll coat the clothes in a release and then paint a plaster silica mixture onto the clothing and build up the layers from there and flip the mold over and pull out the dress so that I have a cavity in the mold that can then be put into a kiln and brought up to a super high temperature, and you melt the cold glass into the cavity of the mold. You can also do it like a lost wax process. You can make a mold from rubber off of a form and get a wax and manipulate the wax and use the same plastic silica process, melt out the wax, and then have your mold that you actually melt the glass into to get the object.
So, and when you cast your objects, are the objects destroyed or are they preserved in that process?
Some of them have been destroyed. It depends on the object themselves. I have a couple of dresses that are made with different layers of lace, and some is a little bit thicker and some is really thin, so pulling it out of the mold can tear it and destroy it, but I still hold on to all of them.
Yeah. So, and something that I found really interesting in doing this show is that it seems like both of you take objects from the past and sort of remake or reimagine them in glass. And I'm wondering if you could tell us a little bit about why you feel that transformation in glass is important for these objects. So Kip, what are your thoughts on that?
I guess I find objects from the past to be a really rich source of inspiration. Partly just because many of them influence our lives today, but they're totally forgotten. And just throwing a little bit of light on them by remaking them in sort of the wrong material is very interesting to me. And I guess I have a natural bent toward just digging around in old objects. I love going in antique stores and finding things that I have no idea what they could possibly have been for, and then sort of trying to work it out by examining them. And objects from the past also have the capacity to describe history in a different and more personal way. So I guess that's a lot of the reasons why I'm drawn to old stuff.
Yeah, that's something that, of course, we feel very strongly about in the museum world, is this capacity for objects to, you know, hold histories and stories and, you know, spark learning. So I love that, having a mystery object that you want to go out and find out more about. So Sarah Beth, Kit mentioned about antique hunting, and I think you have a similar interest.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I definitely love being in any antique or thrift store. I think Kit and I live in different decades by like what we make and collect. I like a lot of things from the 70s and previous, but I'm not necessarily searching for like 16th century objects. A lot of my collections have started with my grandmother collected porcelain dolls, and she had a room dedicated to them. And I grew up in her house and around the dolls. It's really amazing to be able to sort of heighten the value and like the preciousness of those objects again in a different way. And they seem to have like more of a power to last longer by recreating them in glass.
Mm-hmm. And Sarah Beth, too, we had a couple of images on the screen of your dresses. And I think some of those amazing details that you capture in the glass, they're almost more apparent in that form than, you know, maybe even the original. But I think that was one of the exciting things that you mentioned about casting things, is capturing those small details.
Yeah, I'm definitely interested in all of the little details that are lace or frill or a small flower. And I think by choice of different color, especially like an opaque color, is gonna let me like really emphasize that texture. And if I'm working with transparency in certain places, I can almost make that go away or make it flush. The texture and little things that you might not notice, or that's kind of what's important to me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and one of the central concepts, as I mentioned, behind this exhibition was, you know, really this concept of time. And I feel like that's definitely a thread that runs through both of your work. So, Kit, can you talk about some of the ways that you see your work as relating to the concept of time?
Yeah, sure. So it has the very literal connection of often being related to objects that do not exist in our current time. And then I think more important for me is the idea of craft as a stand-in for time, or as a physical representation of time. Craft is the process of building up these lifelong skills, and building up those skills can't really happen without the passage of time. And so every time you use those skills, it's almost like a visual manifestation of time.
Yeah, almost like we experience the passage of time just through the time it took you to craft one of those objects.
Yeah, through the time that it takes to actually make the individual objects, but then also just the time that it takes to build up the skills to be able to make those objects. So it's sort of a double representation of time in that way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and actually I can see that we have a question coming through on social media. This is from Sarah Rincon, and she asked, how long does it take to make one of your works? So maybe this is a good time to insert that question. I'm sure that varies, but Kit, generally, how long does it take for you to make some of these objects?
It takes forever. They take so long. they can take, smaller ones can take several weeks, larger ones can take up to 6 months. So it's quite a lot of time.
Yeah, what about you, Sarah Beth? How long does it take you to make some of your cast pieces?
It can take a long time, especially for casting, because of the kiln process. When you have a really thick piece of glass, you have to spend a longer amount of time in the kiln to make sure that it cools slow enough that you're not going to crack it. So yes, the kiln process itself can take from a week or longer. And that's not including making the mold and then cleaning up the glass afterwards.
Yeah, you've mentioned that the cold working portion of that process is actually very time consuming. Mm-hmm. So what goes into that?
The cold working part is like once you have your glass made and you've divested and removed all of the mold material, you have to do a lot of cleanup. So there might be some sharp edges, or you might want to polish certain areas to shine up the glass. So you work through different abrasives to do all of that work, and also the hanging mechanisms on the backside of the glass take a lot of grinding and some gluing to put all of that together.
Mm-hmm. So, you know, Kit, you mentioned about, you know, this concept of time, you know, your pieces are sort of objects in some cases that don't exist anymore in our world, you know, things that we're not necessarily used to seeing. And I'm thinking, you know, of like the stereoscope, for instance, which, you know, was very popular in the 1850s, but not many of us have a stereoscope these days. Skills that have been built over generations. Sarah Beth, how do you see your work as relating to the concept of time?
I would say most of my work references like childhood or like acts of play, which as an adult were far away from that time and those moments that we just sort of use our imaginations to create these stories with objects. So like for me, casting the objects that we use to play with or has been previously handled by a child is a like kind of a nostalgic thing. I've had a woman come up to me and tell me that she really was inspired by my dresses because they reminded her of her childhood and her mother. And this woman, I would say, was at least in her 70s. And that's exactly sort of the connection that I'm trying to create through these objects.
Mm-hmm. Like a broader understanding of childhood that many of us can actually connect with. So going back to that image of sunk, because I think that's a really interesting piece in the show. Tell us a little bit more about that piece, because here we have this teapot that I think a number of us can connect with as well.
Yeah, so this piece is pretty special because it's a huge piece of glass that's really polished, so you can see the actual teapot is a negative space, so it's a cavity. You're seeing a silhouette of it through the glass, and it's magnified because of the density of the glass. And with certain light, you can barely see the teapot. And then with other lights, you can start to see it kind of reveal itself. And I think that also plays with the idea of memory. And how your memory is accurate or not, or how just like how feelings kind of come out of thinking about these past times.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I'm just seeing this comment on social media about you know, sort of admiration for your work. So we have a comment from Anthony D'Amico. And he says, both of these artists produce gorgeous and lush work. So that's a compliment to both of you. And then we have a question coming in from Rachel Gibby. And you know, this is sort of thinking about the glass community right now. She asks, what is it like being a female artist working in glass today? Kit, do you have thoughts on that, being a female artist in the glass world?
Yeah, I prefer not to be thought of as a female artist. I think calling oneself a female artist really kind of, you paint yourself in a corner a little bit. The glass world has always been a place of equality for me, possibly more even than the real world. I find it to be a very open and accepting place.
And I think a lot of artists in the glass community really speak very highly of the, you know, the colleagues that they have in the glass community. So Sarah Beth, what are your thoughts on that, being a female glass artist working today?
I feel similar to Kit. I think like it's something that as a woman in any field, I think we have to own and like sort of announce ourselves as women, but things specifically in the Black community, I feel like everyone is very supportive of each other, no matter who you are. And that's one thing that's really specific to Glass, I feel sometimes, because we tend to work really close to each other and our community is small, but it's super rich as far as the people that are involved.
Absolutely. So, and what about the Penland environment? Talk to us about that. What's it like being an artist, you know, residing and working at Penland School of Craft?
It's an incredibly vibrant community, both the people who are permanently situated around Penland and also just a constant rotating cast of super interesting, talented, wonderful people coming through because of the school, teaching at the school and being involved with the school in various ways. So it's a very inspiring environment to be around. And it also can be kind of a little much with all of those super fascinating people coming through all the time. It can almost be a little bit too much energy sometimes, but it's pretty wonderful. It's a pretty wonderful place to work.
Yeah, absolutely. So, and what about you, Therba?
It's amazing. Kit's basically my neighbor in a way. And yeah, it's awesome because you don't have to really go too far to have a conversation with someone else that is as interested as you are in making or the history of making and material. And because there are so many different artists and different materials, you're always influenced by something that you might not necessarily go to first thing, which is great.
Mm-hmm. Sort of broadening how you think about your own work.
For sure.
We have a question from Thomas Cornell. And he asks, so much of the glass is a community process. So how are each of you handling the need to self-isolate during this period? And what will be the first thing you do when you're free to be with other people?
I guess I've been... I think both of us, both Sarah Beth and I, we tend toward the parts of the glass world that are a little bit more solitary than the hot shop. So I've been able to continue my practice in my own studio all by myself, I'm incredibly thankful for that, incredibly grateful for that. I don't know what I would do. I get stir crazy if I don't get to make things. So I'm very lucky that I get to keep making things during this time.
Yeah, I've been experimenting with lots of things recently, like performance on days that I want to be a clown, to sewing. I've actually traveled up to Pittsburgh, where my boyfriend lives, who's also a flame worker, and I have a torch set up here. So I've been able to keep flame working and building a lot of samples for when the studios are like full access again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and one question I had, so it seemed like from talking with you and my research that the act of collecting things was something that was important to both of you. And I'm wondering if you can tell us a little bit about what you collect and how that informs your artwork, but also kind of tying into that question, you know, what happens now when you can't get out to collect things? So Kit, what kind of collector are you?
I don't necessarily collect real objects, I guess. That's sort of a strange answer. But I guess I make up my own culture. So I'm in isolation, I'm perfectly able to continue to invent those collections and add to them. And also just I'm still able to continue visual research. I guess that's maybe where my collections lies, in visual research. So collecting piles of pictures of things. So I'm still able to do that, although I do miss rooting around in antique shops.
Well, and I'm thinking too of your Magpie Museum of Disorderly Inquiry. Can you tell us about that? I feel like that's a collection of objects right there.
That is definitely a collection of objects. So that started that project. I don't know whether to call it a all-consuming project or an alter ego or a museum. It's somewhere in between all of those. And that started as my thesis work when I was working on my master's at Southern Illinois University. And I really wanted to make objects that related to each other so that they function as individual objects, but they also bounce stories off of each other and they create this greater story together. So I have that set up in my studio now. So about half of my studio is devoted to this sort of museum collection, this sort of made up collection, and the other half is actual usable studio.
Yeah, I find that fascinating as somebody who works in museums to have this artist kind of compiling a museum of their own. So Sarah Beth, what about your collecting interests?
I realized like last week that I really, really miss going into antique stores and thrift stores. And so we have been driving around neighborhoods. Pittsburgh's super dense and there are so many neighborhoods, and like I've been collecting images of different like windows and frames around homes and things that are covered in ivy and fencing. So these visual collections right now are feeding that part of me that needs to like grasp on to older things. I think the buildings here just have this amazing history. Most of them, the ones that I'm drawn to, aren't occupied. So seeing like how they're withholding or not withholding over time is still fascinating.
A comment from Jim Miller, who says, thanks for this informative live stream. So we appreciate that. Thanks, Jim. And we have a question from Greg McPherson, who's our exhibition designer at the WC Fine Art Museum. We've talked a little bit about, you know, how the past or objects from the past have inspired your work, but Greg asks, are either of you working with objects that reference this, the present time? And if so, what are those objects? Sarah Beth, we have actually, there's a piece in the show that I think references the present.
I'm trying to recall right now.
If we could bring the pillow on the screen.
Oh yeah, for sure. That's the only work in the show that is blown glass. It's a Hot Shop sculpted, and that series was made thinking about sort of like restful moments, and I was trying to think of like what type of object brings you to a pause, and for me that is meditation, and they're referencing a pillow and somewhere where you might rest your head, or if you're meditating, you might have a seat that you sit on. So yeah, for sure the pillows are something that are referencing being still in the moment.
And Kit, does any of your work, do you feel like it's actually rooted in the present?
I guess sometimes when I'm not recreating an object that already existed, sometimes I invent objects that look like they are old, and I guess that would be my connection to the present, is if it didn't exist in the past, I have to invent it in the present. But honestly, the current day objects are not of particular interest to me, the way old objects are.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's just a richness to some things that we draw from the past that I know fascinate you. So we have our question coming in from Terry Grant L, and they ask, which came first, the object or the concept? So the question is, did you want to discuss the concept of time and this led to the object choice, or did you like the object and as you worked with it, a concept emerged?
I think for me, I would have to say both. Sometimes one follows the other. Sometimes they move at the same speed. Sometimes one lags behind a little bit, but it's for the most part, those things happen at the same time. Very rarely do I figure everything out in advance and figure out what my object is saying before I start making my object.
Mm-hmm. But your work, it takes a lot of planning though. I mean, in terms of, you know, you talked about drawing, and you also do some bridging to create your works. So there is a lot of planning involved in the process.
Yeah, I definitely plan out how to make an object. Sometimes the ideas that go along with that object happen at the same time as the planning, but sometimes the object will be planned before I know exactly why I'm making it. But it doesn't make for less planning, for sure.
Yeah. So, and Sarah Beth, what about you? Object first or concept that drives you?
I'd have to say specifically with the series and the show, it's also kind of a simultaneous thing, because the objects that I am referring to with the dresses are derived from my grandmother's collection of dolls, which those objects exist, but I'm also trying to cherish the memory that I have connected to the objects and to my grandmother. So trying to heighten the value or the preciousness is more of the concept rather than just wanting to make a dress.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and actually from a curatorial perspective on this project, the exhibition, we sort of went through a couple of different concepts, you know, to create a framework for Sarah Beth and Kit's, you know, work in glass. And so the concept of time for the show itself, I think, came out of having conversations. Sarah Beth, we talked on the phone a couple of times, and, you know, Kit, I was researching your work. And so it seemed to evolve naturally just from, you know, having those conversations and finding out more about how you both work and what your objects, you know, are ultimately about. So that was the exhibition concept emerged, you know, from your interests as artists. We have a question from Corey Pemberton, and they asked, do either of you consider your work to be political in nature? And do you take into consideration the politics of the era that your source materials come from? Kit, you want to offer your thoughts on that question?
Yeah, I don't think my work is overtly political other than just being a comment on my feelings about the world we exist in, which is it's sort of inherently political, but I think learning more about one of the things about studying material culture history is that stories will come along with an object, and a lot of those stories looking back in history are somewhat political. I think probably for me, the closest I get is just musings on the effects of the Industrial Revolution that has a lot to do with the objects I make. So
that's yeah, what's a specific example of that? One of the objects that you've made that have related to like the Industrial Revolution, for instance?
I guess that there's a piece in the show, the cravat after Grinling Gibbons. And so there's an English wood carver in the late 1600s named Grinling Gibbons who carved these in sort of trompe l'oeil, wood carvings, very, very large scale, incredibly, incredibly detailed. They're detailed enough to fool the eye somewhat.
Mm-hmm. We have an image of that piece, that cravat.
Yeah. So that piece is brought up in a book by Glenn Adamson called, I think it's The Invention of Craft. And he talks about how wood carving was one of the sort of holdouts against the Industrial Revolution. So one of the last crafts to be mechanized, and sort of a measure of mechanization was the ability to imitate the detail of hand carved wood by a machine. And that piece has a little bit to do with that sort of imitation as a measure of craft.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so Sarah Beth, do you feel like your work is political at all?
I wouldn't say that I'm very political with my existence, period. There are definitely underlying themes, I think, just by nature that a lot of my work references mostly feminine objects, and the not necessarily about being a woman, but the qualities of what feminism is. Other than that, I try to not really go into that realm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so let's see, we have another question. This is actually specifically for Kit. And this is coming from the WCU School of Stage and Screen Facebook page. And they ask, Kit, many of your works are wearable. What has inspired you to make glass objects that are functional in this way?
I guess I have sort of a side interest in garment construction. For a very long time, before I went back to grad school, I wasn't really making art at all, but I was doing all sorts of other craft practices. Specifically, I did a lot of garment making, and the structure of how clothing is put together kind of informs a lot of those wearable pieces. But that's sort of a side reason why I go in that direction, I guess. I think initially one of the first pieces that I made that was wearable was mostly about sort of this struggle as an artist. So I think a lot of us as artists are pretty introverted people, but as an artist, you really have to put yourself out there, and it can be very difficult to be opinionated in your work, to say this is how I feel about this thing. I'm going to make this piece of art, and I am in that. And so the first wearable piece is a way of being able to actually hide in the piece itself. So that was where that came from initially.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I guess I'm interested too. I mean, Kate, you mentioned about putting yourself out there as an artist, and you know, the exhibition at the museum is, you know, an amazing group of objects by both of you, but I know that you both have, you know, new projects that you've taken on recently and, you know, pursuing new ideas. So tell us a little bit about, you know, what your current projects are. Sarah Beth, what are you working on these days?
Right now, I've kind of got two different things I'm working on. One that I'm really excited about that sort of references my driving around the neighborhoods. I'm working with steel and copper wire, trying to figure out how to make like fencing and chain link. So I'm working on samples to be able to build up a larger structure with wire, actually.
Mm-hmm. And Kit, do you have some new and exciting things happening in your world?
Yeah, so when the quarantine started, I decided that I was gonna make a piece every single day, sort of, one, because I just didn't know what else to do. I was sort of at a loss for anything to do, and I figured that a good way out of that confusion was to just keep making and to set an assignment for myself of making a piece every single day. And then also as a way of marking time too. So at the end of this quarantine, I will have this description of that time in objects. So I've been working with that, although I've kind of tapered off on that because 40 days, as it turns out, is a very long time to make an object every single day. And then the other thing that I'm working on is a larger, longer scale project is things with moving parts. So learning how to make gears in glass and crankshafts and camshafts so that I can make objects that move, which has been really, really interesting. I think you can see one of them on the table behind me. There's a little.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, actually, and I think we have some images from your quarantine project that we can share with the audience.
Oh yeah, some of those have a little dog with little moving feet. Some of those have had moving parts. That was sort of where I started exploring that idea of moving parts.
Mm-hmm. Well, so as a last question, let me ask you both this. So, you know, Western has had this long history of exhibiting glass, and I think we're really proud to be a place that, you know, kind of keeps the conversation going about studio glass, especially in the United States, and celebrating glass in North Carolina. And I think this exhibition is also one that I'm really happy celebrates the role of women artists working in glass and studio glass today. But just to leave our audience with sort of a tidbit from you, what do you find most inspiring about working in your glass medium?
I guess I am inspired by the fact that it remains a really difficult material to work with. I've been working with it for almost 20 years, and I still find out new things about it pretty often, and that is delightful, and that keeps me coming back and working with the material.
Yeah, and Sarah Beth, what about you?
I think similar, like there are so many different techniques in glass. I have ADD and I'm a Gemini, so it's like, oh, I can try this, I can do that. And you can make like a sphere in so many different ways. It's a challenge every time. And just glass itself is an amazing material. Seeing something made in it as small or large is always like just breathtaking. And it's hard to not want to play with it all the time.
Yeah, and I'm always excited about having glass exhibitions. Just, you know, the way that light interacts with those pieces and I don't know, the way that glass captures ideas, I think is just really remarkable. So thank you both for being here with us today. I'm really glad that we could bring you together in conversation. And there's some amazing things coming out of the Penland campus. So we're really happy to have both of you talk to us today about your work. So I'm gonna turn it back to Denise to close our program. Thank you to everybody who submitted a question. We appreciate it.
Yeah, I wanna second that thanks to Kit and Sarah Beth. Thank you for joining us today. And also Carolyn, thank you for moderating the discussion. I want to apologize to some of our Facebook viewers. We dropped off our feed dropped off of Facebook for a little bit, but we're back live now. So apologies there. Again, thank you for your questions. I also want to thank again the Art Alliance for Contemporary Glass for their support of this exhibition and public programming. I also want to acknowledge two people, Jasmine Hodgson, who is a stage and screen major who created the intro video for the exhibition that you saw at the opening of this of this event. And also acknowledge Greg McPherson, our exhibition designer, who skillfully installed the show. We miss seeing you in person at the WC Fine Art Museum. We hope to see you again soon in person. If you're interested in seeing more of these virtual events, you can check our website, sign up for our e-newsletter, or just join us on social media. So our next virtual live experience is actually going to be Controlled Chaos's Virtual Film Festival on May 8th at 7:30 p.m. And that's a program hosted by the WCU Stage School of Stage and Screen. So we hope you join us there on May 8th. Again, thank you all for joining us. And until we see you again in person, be well.